Today I'm going to try and show that E is an irrational number. So E is this fantastic number, shall I just write it? It's 2.718 and it goes on and on and on and on and on. And it plays a role in just about every aspect of physics. It seems to be everywhere in maths. Some staggeringly important number.
What do you call that amongst yourselves? Like, what do you just call it E or do you call it the...
I call it E, yeah. Just friendly.
And if someone at the pubs came up to you and said, hey Ed, I know you mathematicians and physicists have this number called E and you all really like it and it's important. What actually is E? What would you say to them?
Oh, defining E is a... The way I like to define E is it's the only number which, if I differentiate it, I get back to itself again. So let me try and show you. So this is E, but if I raise E to some power x, say, so x could be 1, it could be 2, so it could be e squared, or it could be 3, e cubed, then if I plot this as a function of x, then it does something like the following. When x equals 0, e to the 0 is 1, so it begins at 1. And then as I increase x, this grows, so e is roughly 3, so when x equals 1, this has got a value of roughly 3. And when x is 2, e's got a value roughly, you know, it's e squared, which is roughly 3 squared, right, which is of order 9. So you can see it's rising up fairly rapidly. Now I could ask the question, what's the slope of this function, right? You know, if a slope we learn at school is drawing a tangent at any point, it will tell me the slope. So that would be the tangent at that point there, and this would be the tangent at that point there. And if I plot the tangent, then I actually get, maybe the tangent should be in red, perhaps, I will basically get this. So that's the tangent. Imagine e to the x is telling me about the distance I've travelled as a function of time. X here is time, so these are maybe seconds, 1 second, 2 seconds, 3 seconds. And then I decide, actually, it's not just the distance I need, it's the actual velocity I need. I need the rate of change of the distance. So that's the slope. Well, the rate of change of the distance is exactly the same function. Okay, so then I say, well, all right, actually, what I really need, I need the acceleration. I need to know how fast this velocity is changing. And if I do the same again, that's the slope of the velocity. So it's the same curve again. So the velocity curve, which has to be in black, the acceleration curve, which has to be in black, is exactly the same again. So this exponential function, e to the x, is the only one that if I differentiate it, so if I work out d by dx of e to the x, then I get e to the x. So it's the same. And then if I work out the next differential of it, I get e to the x. And it goes on and on and on and on. And that's the beauty of this particular function, that all of its derivative, all of its slopes match the actual function itself.
Why is that useful?
I don't know why it's useful in particular. I don't know what it is about that property that means it plays such an important role. I mean, in terms of calculations, it makes things incredibly straightforward because you can just do this. But in terms of its actual physical or mathematical properties, I'm not sure what it is about that. It means it carries on forever, okay, because the slope just keeps, no matter how far you go, whereas other functions will die off if you differentiate them. But the fact it's keeping exactly the same behaviour is one of the most intriguing things. So what we want to do today is to demonstrate that this number, which goes on and on and on and on forever and ever, cannot be represented as a ratio of two integers. That's what an irrational number is. A rational number can always be represented as the ratio of two integers.
A fraction.
In fact, they're made up of relative prime integers, but that's just a technicality. Here we're going to demonstrate that E cannot be done that. It's a proof due to Fourier, that absolutely brilliant mathematician. I think it's okay. I think we'll be able to do it.
Okay, so you're going to prove that E is irrational.
Yeah, so let's do the proof. E is irrational. And I wish it was my proof, but it's not. It's due to Joseph Fourier.
I've been to his grave.
Have you?
Yeah.
Doesn't mention this in it. He did so many things.
And it's in Paris. It's in the famous cemetery in Paris.
Yeah.
It's a cool grave. He looks like Voldemort
Does
there's like a bust of him on it, and he looks like Voldemort. Just saying.
Spooky. Spooky.
Anyway.
So let's do it. So what do I mean by that? I mean that E cannot be represented as by the ratio of two integers as a fraction, as you say. So P and Q are known as relative prime integers. You know, no matter how big your integers are, you will not be able to represent E. And so the proof is done in the following way. You assume that this isn't the case. It's like James did with this square root of, showing the square root of 2 was irrational. You assume that actually you can work it. And then you show there's an inconsistency. So you assume that E can be represented as the ratio of two integers. And the one thing that I'm hoping you will allow me to write down is there is a representation of E that I can write down. So we can write that E has an infinite series expansion. It's 1 plus 1 over 1 factorial, 1 over 2 factorial, so 1 over 3 factorial, and it goes on and on and on.
This is just common knowledge.
This is common knowledge. You do this at school. My daughter's done AS level. She's been doing this. There's this infinite series expansion of E, where 3 factorial, just to remind everyone, is 1 times 2 times 3. That's all it is. So now what I want to do is, let me call this equation 1, all right? And I'll call this equation 2. So I'm going to multiply equation 2 by q factorial. So there's this q here, okay? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to multiply this expression by q factorial. So the left-hand side becomes q factorial times e. And what does the right-hand side become? Well, it becomes q factorial plus q factorial over 1 factorial plus q factorial over 2 factorial plus q factorial over q factorial, because I eventually reach the qth term, but then there's a whole series of other terms which, for now, let's just call them the rest, right? There'll be a q factorial over q plus 1 factorial and a q factorial over q plus 2 factorial. It just goes on forever. But we know from our assumption that E equals P over Q, okay? And that then means that Q factorial times E, this is equal to, what is that equal to? That's equal to Q minus 1 factorial times Q times E, because that's what Q factorial is. It's Q minus 1 factorial times Q. But we already know that Q times E equals P. So this is just Q minus 1 factorial times P. So this is an integer. That's the key point here. Q minus 1 factorial is just an integer, P is just an integer, so the product of them is just an integer. So Q factorial times E, the left-hand side of this expression, is an integer. Okay? Now let me look at the right-hand side of this expression. Well, hopefully, you can be convinced that this thing that I've underlined here, this is also an integer. Q factorial is just an integer. This is Q factorial over 1, well, that's just an integer. This is Q factorial over 2 factorial, where the 2's cancel. Yeah. So this here is also an integer. This is an integer, this is an integer. This then implies that the rest must be an integer, right? I can't have an integer here, and have this not being an integer. Otherwise it would, imagine this was a half, then I'd have an integer equals an integer plus a half, and that's not right. So the rest must be an integer. Okay, so now I'm going to concentrate on the rest, right? So what is the rest? Well, we also have that the rest, let me call it R, right, for the rest. What is it? It's Q factorial, because that's what I multiplied everything by, into, and it's all these other expressions. So it's 1 over q plus 1 factorial plus 1 over q plus 2 factorial plus, well, let me do the next one, q plus 3 factorial, and it goes on forever and ever like this, okay? I can now divide out because, you know, this, imagine q was 6. This would be 6 factorial divided by 7 factorial, so it would be 1 over 7. That would be all that's left. So this is just equal to 1 over q plus 1 plus 1 over, and this is 1 over q plus 1 times 1 over q plus 2, and this is just, you get the idea, 1 over q plus 1 times 1 over q plus 2 times 1 over q plus 3 plus dot dot dot. Okay. And what I can do, I can simplify this. I can bring out a 1 over q plus 1 into the front, and so this becomes 1 plus 1 over q plus 2 plus 1 over q plus 2 times q plus 3. Okay, and it goes on forever and ever and ever. So the key point now that I want to make is that this is what the rest is. It's exactly this. But the proof, the key thing of the proof now comes in the fact that I know that this has to be less than the following. Well, I keep the 1 over q plus 1. I keep the 1. Now, 1 over q plus 2 is less than 1 over q plus 1, right? Imagine q was 6 again. Then 1 over 8 is less than 1 over 7. Similarly here, this is less than 1 over q plus 1 squared, right? Because this would be 1 over 8 times 1 over 9, which is clearly less than 1 over 7 squared. And it just goes on like that, right? That this is less than this. Now this number here is less than 1, because q is going to be bigger than 1. This is less than 1. There's a beautiful little proof due to Gauss, and I'm going to prove it for you so that we can then just finish this off. Gauss apparently did this when he was about 3.
Right.
All right. So there's the following. If x, some number, is less than 1, then we have the sum of n terms, which is 1 plus x squared plus x cubed plus up to x to the n. You can see what's going to happen, right? My x's are going to be my 1 over q plus 1's, because these will be the thing that is less than 1. That's where... Now, let me do the following. Gauss did this. X times that, right, is equal to, and then it becomes, I multiply the 1, I get the x squared, I get the x cubed, I'm going to get the term that's x to the n, and then if I multiply x to the n by x, I get one last term, which is x to the n plus 1. And I've shifted them all along so that you can see that if I take one of these away from the other, all these terms cancel, leaving me with just the first term and the last term. So in particular, it turns out that Sn into 1 minus x, so I've just taken the second term from the first term, equals, well, there's nothing to take away from the 1. They cancel, they cancel, they cancel, everything cancels, that cancels, and I'm just left with that last term, 1 minus x to the n plus 1. Now, the series we've got is an infinite series. This series ends after n terms. This series goes on to infinity. So what happens as n goes to infinity? As n goes to infinity, because x is less than 1, x to the n plus 1 goes to 0. Imagine a half. If I keep a half times a half is a quarter, times a half is an eighth, times a half is a sixteenth, it just gradually goes towards 0. So the x to the n plus 1 goes to 0. We're nearly there, Brady. Hang in there. So this means that s infinity is 1 over 1 minus x. So this sum I can now do, because x is, I'm just replacing x by 1 over q plus 1. This s infinity for me becomes 1 over 1 minus 1 over q plus 1. And that is equal to q plus 1 over q, right? That's just rearranging this. So if I come back to the all-important remainder, the rest, this thing here that I'm trying to bound, I've said it must be an integer. So the remainder, I know it has to be less than 1 over q plus 1 times by this sum. Well, this is this sum. So it's times q plus 1 over q. So the q plus 1's cancel. So this is r must be less than 1 over q. Okay. Right, we're nearly there now, because we already know that r has to be positive, because it's just a sum of positive terms. So r is greater than 0, which means that for this proof to work, r is bounded between 0 and 1 upon q, but q is bigger than 1. So this is a fraction, less than 1, i.e. r is less than 1, which means it cannot be an integer. Therefore, e cannot be represented as a rational number, so it has to be irrational. Da-da.
All right, good. This episode has been brought to you by KiwiCo. Get these boxes, or crates as they like to call them, delivered right to your home. Then marvel at your own engineering prowess as you follow the clear and clever instructions to build all sorts of ingenious devices. I felt like this occupied some fascinating middle ground between, well, just plain fun and something that's really educational. I was also really impressed by the design and materials. Where was this when I was a youngster? When you order one of these crates, you can subscribe to all sorts of levels depending on who's going to be doing the building. Here I'm working on a tinker crate that's suitable for anyone from basically about 9 years and up. Everything you need's in the box. Batteries are included if they're part of the build. Learn, play, and get 50% off your first crate by using the URL kiwico.com/numberphile. Give them a try. I really think you'll be impressed. It's a great family activity too if you happen to be doing some home education. kiwico.com/numberphile. And here is my finished ballista.